Welcome to the Orange Blossom Opry. At this time, we ask that you please silence all cell phones and pagers, and as you know, flash photography and video recording is not allowed. We also ask that you please remove all caps and hats so the people behind and around you can enjoy the view. Gum chewing is not allowed, and please don't stick it under your seat. We're happy that you've joined us here at the Orange Blossom Opry and ask that you please take all refuse with you to the nearest exit as you leave the auditorium. And now, ladies and gentlemen, sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Orange Blossom Opry. How y'all doing tonight? Everybody okay? All right, we got some folks in here. Sure glad to see y'all. Thank you so much for coming out. Tonight we're going to do a show that's a little bit about the story of the Grand Ole Opry. How many folks have been to the Grand Ole Opry in Nashville? Every one of you have been there. All right. Well, how many of y'all think that the Grand Ole Opry started out like an Opry show, just a big old show like we have here? Do you know that it didn't? That the beginning of the Orange Blossom Opry, the Grand Ole Opry, I'll probably be confused all night, actually began back in 1926 when WSM started a radio company, or started their own little radio show. Do you know what WSM stands for? How many people listen to WSM in Nashville, Tennessee? Not a soul. One person. You, the lady that probably turned the heat up. Whoever turns the heat up, I'm going to kill them. Because they do it every night, just after rehearsal, they turn the heat up and then I get up here. Anyway, that's Nancy, our cook, and she's fixing the heat. WSM stands for We Shield Millions, and it was a life insurance company back in the 20s. And so back in those days in radio, there wasn't a lot of programming and there wasn't a lot of hogwash like it's on TV and radio today. But what was on there was advertisements. So WSM had a big advertisement that would run all day talking to people about buying life insurance, because that was a big thing back in the 20s. You would know, sir, right? You were just merely a teenager then. And you sit in the front, you get picked on. That's just the way it goes, all right? Anyway, and so what they did is they'd have a little sideshow because they got tired of just talking about life insurance, kind of like you're getting tired of me talking. And what happened is this little sideshow kind of started to take on a life of its own. And in November 28th of 1925, they decided, let's turn this into a show. Let's make this its own little entity, its own little show. So they signed on with a show called the WSM Barn Dance. Now, it wasn't anything at all like what you would think, because this is in the stages of a little radio station in the basement or of a show. I think I heard it was on the fifth floor, but it doesn't matter where it is. But we want to take you back to what it may have sounded like in 1925 when they kicked off the very first, what turned out to be the Grand Ole Opry show. We're going to have Doug Stock come up here, and he's going to, I guess the first guy that came on the Grand Ole Opry was a lot like Doug. He was 77 years old. His name was Jimmy Thompson. Uncle Jimmy Thompson. Everybody was an uncle back then, weren't they? Uncle Jimmy Thompson. So here's Uncle Doug Stock to show you a little bit what you may have sounded like on day one, I guess.
Well, yes, it is. And an interesting thing about him that people wound up liking him so much and called in so much about it that he wound up setting the tone for what was going to be played on the Opry for years and years. It went a little bit like this.
Everybody. So that's kind of how it all started out, because it was all acoustic. They didn't have any loud electric instruments up there, no drums. And as you'll learn today, they went for many years that they wouldn't let drums and electric instruments on the Grand Ole Opry. But what started to happen is because the radio station had such a large radio antenna that put out like 100,000 watts, it would go all over the country. And what they started noticing is these guys on the radio started becoming stars. I don't believe there was a television in 1925. Was there, sir? Did you all have TV then? You didn't? You don't remember? Yeah, all right, not that old. Anyway, so what happens are these guys start to become stars. Now you can start to see what's starting to happen in Nashville back in the 20s. And Dougie's going to tell you about one of the very first stars that came off of the Grand Ole Opry show in about 1926.
Uncle Dave Mason, he was a banjo player, a singer-songwriter, and a comedian who worked in vaudeville in the early 1920s. But by the end of the 20s, he had become the very first Grand Ole Opry star. If people say that Jimmy Rogers is the father of country music, if that's so, then certainly Uncle Dave Mason has to be the grandfather. Here's a little song that he might have done. Far from me, there's no hollow tree. I'll dip down a dollar or two, and I'd go around the bend and come back again with a quart of that good old Mountain Dew. Yeah, they call it that good old Mountain Dew, Dew, Dew. And them that refuse it are few. I'll dip in my mug if you fill up my jug, that good old Mountain Dew. About 5'2", but he feels like a giant when you give him a pint of that good old Mountain Dew. Yeah, they call it that good old Mountain Dew, Dew, Dew. And them that refuse it are few. I'll hush up my mug if you fill up my jug with that good old Mountain Dew. Yeah, that good old Mountain Dew.
That's Doug Stock, everybody. All right, so the 20s keep moving along, and in the 1930s, now the Grand Ole Opry is kind of taking on a life of its own, and people start moving to Nashville because they realize, if you've seen that movie, Oh Brother, How Great Thou Art, or whatever that was, you had to go to Nashville because if you could get on the Grand Ole Opry, you could maybe become a country music star because you could get on that radio show, people would know who you are, and then you could go out and play, because you could go to, where are you from, sir? Ocala? Okay, I got an easier question, though. So if you could hear the Grand Ole Opry in Ocala, you could go to Ocala, because people would want to see you, because you were a star on the radio. So that's kind of what started happening. Now, the most influential guy that moved to Nashville, Tennessee, in the 30s, was a guy named Roy Acuff. Now, there was many guys that joined the Grand Ole Opry back then. Bob Wills, Pee Wee King, Cousin Jody, Bill Monroe joined in 1939. But Roy Acuff is probably the most important guy, and as we go through the show, I'll tell you why. Because he's the guy who really created everything. He created music publishing, not created it, but really helped it happen in Nashville. Songwriters and songs and artists and record labels. So we're going to do you a little Roy Acuff song here and say what it may have sounded a little something like this. If you remember Roy, he kicked everything off with, what was the dobro player's name? Oswald. Well, not the guy that shot Kennedy, the other one, right? Well, he may have shot Kennedy. We don't know. It was all a conspiracy. Anyway, here we go. Oh, let her go, boy. Come on, Miles. From the great Atlantic Ocean to the wide Pacific shore, from the streaming flowy mountains to the Southfield by the shore. She's mighty tall and handsome, and she's known quite well by all. She's a combination, she's a Wabash cannonball. Sing along, boys. Why don't you listen to the jingle, the rum?
rumble and the roar as she glides along the woodland through the hills and by the shore. She's mighty tall and handsome, and she's known quite well by all. She's a combination on the Wabash Cannonball. Oh, Dougie! Well, here's to Daddy Claxton, may his name forever stand. May he always be remembered through the South and all the land. His earthly race is over and the curtain on him fell. They carried him off to victory on the Wabash Cannonball. Why don't you listen to the jingle, the rumble and the roar, as she glides along the woodland through the hills and by the shore. She's mighty tall and handsome, and she's known quite well by all. She's a combination on the Wabash Cannonball, tagging down. She's a combination, she's the Wabash Cannonball. Yeah, baby!
Yeah! Yeah, that's what the thing is. The headstock of the bass, speaking of the headstock, is in the Doug Stock's way. So with the camera, so we're going to try to move that a little bit. Okay, so the 30s, here's what happens, is Roy Acuff is on the radio and becoming a big star, because WSM radio at night, how many of y'all could listen to the Grand Ole Opry somewhere a long way away? Because I could hear it up in Michigan. Could you not? Where could you hear it from, hon? Your jail cell? Okay. I can't hear you if you don't speak up. And I'm sorry, I know you have the... But anyway, the point is, you could hear the Grand Ole Opry from everywhere. Especially at night. So Roy Acuff starts traveling around and doing these shows because people think he is a star and he's becoming a star. Well, he would find people out in the country that are working around, and he went to Arlen and my hometown, or close to it. He went to Saginaw, Michigan, and he did a show up there. And there was a guy working at WSGW radio station in Saginaw doing the same thing. They'd have the commercials all day, and they'd get talking about this, and then they'd break for a guy to sing. They say, well, let's have a little entertainment now by, what was his name? Little Jimmy Dickens. And so Little Jimmy would sing.
He was like so short.
He was a little guy.
Like Macy Max height.
Yeah, could be. Well, so what happened was, when Roy Acuff came to town, Little Jimmy Dickens got on the show and opened up the show for him. And Little Jimmy Dickens, he said, listen, you need to come to Nashville. I'll make you a member of the Grand Ole Opry. And so that's kind of how the Little Jimmy Dickens thing happened. A lot of people think he's from Saginaw, Michigan. He's not. He's from Parkersburg, West Virginia. But what happened is, we all know Little Jimmy Dickens did a lot of crazy songs. Do you know any Little Jimmy Dickens songs? Take an old cold tater and wait, sleeping at the foot of the bed. What you may not know is Little Jimmy Dickens was an unbelievable singer. He was an unbelievable singer. And one of my favorite songs that he did, Arlen's going to perform for you now because it's incredible.
If she seems cold and bitter, then I beg of you, just stop and consider all she's gone through. Don't be quick to condemn her for things she might say. Just remember, life turned her that way. She's been walked on and stepped on so many times. Mine. laughter. She cries harder today, so don't blame her. Life turned her that way.
Let's do it, Dougie.
On and stepped down so many times, and I hate to admit it, but the last footprint's mine. She was crying when I left her. She cries harder today, so don't blame her. Life turned her that way. So don't blame her. Life turned her.
Right there, folks. Little Jimmy Dickens song from the 1940s, and he was quite the singer. Also, now remember, people are starting to migrate to Nashville to become part of the Grand Ole Opry to try to become a country music star. Another gentleman that moved there was a guy by the name of Eddie Arnold. Y'all remember Eddie Arnold? He was kind of a pop singer. He had a little bit of hit, a little bit of success in both arenas, but mostly a country singer. And we're going to call on Arlen again to do...
I didn't know Life Turned Her That Way was even sung before Ricky Van Shelton in the 80s, I think it was, or early 90s, maybe.
Ricky Van Shelton did a cover of it. He did a cover of everything. Yeah. He said he couldn't play without a cover.
But you know why I did it?
No.
Well, okay, so remember when we were trying to get people to tip us a bunch and that one couple gave us like $200?
Yeah.
Okay, that was my friends Tom and Diane Giles.
Yeah, so they'll throw us another $200.
And Sister Dorlinda is in the house right now, and it's her birthday.
So let's do happy birthday for Sister Dorlinda. Let's do happy birthday for Nathan, because it's also Nathan's birthday. And I think it's our boss Heather's birthday as well. So let's rip that up real quick.
All right.
Let's do the fast version.
Here we go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Dorlinda and Nathan.
And Heather.
You're late.
The boss.
You're really late.
Happy birthday to you.
Many more.
Happy birthday from Tom and Diane.
All right. Little Eddie Arnold for you.
Yes.
What key is this in? C?
Yeah.
Yep.
Make the world and get it off my shoulders. Say the things you used to say and make the world go away. Do you remember when I loved you? For the world took you astray. If you do, then forgive me and make the world go away. Make the world go away. And get it off my shoulders.
and make the world go away.
How about some steel guitar? Sorry I hurt you, I'll make it up day by day. Say you love me like you used to, make the world go away. Make the world. Say the things you used to say and make the world go away.
Arnold, well, that right there was some Eddie Arnold stuff. All right. So we're now kind of in the late 40s, and the music business is really starting to pick up, and music and the word is getting out. You got to go to Nashville. So this old skinny boy goes to Nashville in the late 40s, about, I think 48 or 1949, somewhere in there.
Bobby Randall.
And he was, that was me, in the 40s. And what happened was by now Roy Acuff is starting to develop like the music business. He's got a publishing company, which means he's got guys that will write songs for you. So if you're a singer, you can sing. But if you don't know all the songs or you can't write songs, he's got a group of people. He's starting the publishing company and people are writing. So now people are moving to Nashville for several different reasons. I can't sing, but I can write songs. So I moved to Nashville. And so that's kind of what's starting to go on in the late 40s, in the early 50s. So the old boy that moves to town is a guy by the name of Hank Williams. And he moves from Montgomery, Alabama up to Nashville. And he's a pretty rough little character. But he finally got a meeting with a guy named Wesley Rose, who was Roy Acuff's partner, Acuff Rose. And they had a publishing company. And they said, well, I write songs. So he played him some songs. And he said, I wrote all these songs. And according to the story, they didn't believe he wrote all those songs. He said, I don't believe you wrote all these. So they said, go in there and write a song. So they said he came out in 15 minutes. And in 15 minutes... he wrote this song that we'll get Arlen to sing for you. And it takes me 15 minutes to write down this. So imagine writing a song, this song, in 15 minutes.
Hey, hey, good looking. What you got cooking? How's about cooking something out with me? Find us a brand new recipe. I got a hot rod for it and a $2 bill. I know a spot right over the hill. There's soda pop and the dance is free. If you want to go dancing, come along with me. Hey, 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 good looking. What you got cooking? How's about cooking something up with me? Dug it! How's about saving all your time for me? Oh, no more looking. I know I've been cooking. So how's about seeking steady company? I'm gonna throw my date book over the fence and buy me one for 5 or 10 cents. Keep it till it's covered with date. And I'll write your name on every page. Hey, How's about cooking something up? How's about cooking something up? How's about cooking something up with me? Yeah, Hank Williams.
Now we go. All right. But we got it. I guess we'll move along because we had another Hank Jr. or Hank song we'll do. But let's move along because we're gonna we've got a lot of songs that we want to get through tonight. That started Hank Williams' career. And, of course, you all know that he died at 20, was he 29 or 27?
Nine.
29 in 1952 on New Year's Eve Day. And a very short career. And when you think about him, and you know, you think about Hank Williams being this big legend, he was really just a kid when he died. But wrote some incredible songs and paved a lot of way for other people coming to town. Also, what started happening in the 50s, I shouldn't tell you this because he can't defend himself, but Roy Acuff was not a fan of having women on the Grand Ole Opry or having girl singers around. Guys, you can understand that, can't you? No, you're not going to say anything.
What?
No. Well, what he thought, his thought process was that women may not be able to sell tickets, that people would not be excited to see women play or that. So he really kind of shied away from it. There were some girls on earlier in the show.
It's really still that way in Ocala.
It is in Ocala. It's still the same thing. But here's what happened, folks. So, you know, there's records going on now. So the Grand Ole Opry is not the only vehicle to be a star. You know, you could get a record deal now in Nashville and get your records played because now there's radio stations that are playing records. And in 1952, there was a lady that had a huge, big record on the radio, and there was no doubt they had to put her on the Grand Ole Opry. And there's a lot of controversy about the song and a lot of controversy about the lady, but I think we have Katie O back there somewhere, and she's going to come out and tell you a little bit of story about our next song, if Katie O has not got mad at me and went home.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Katie O.
We don't know where Katie O is. So there you are. Is there something you had to do that was more important than come out here and sing with us?
I was back there chatting with Macy Mac.
Now imagine that. All right. Well, Macy go. Mac, so tell them about your girl. What? Tell them about old Kitty.
Well, Kitty Wells, also known as the Queen of Country Music, had this hit song that took her to the top. Here's "It Wasn't God Who Made Honky Tonk Angels." As I sit here tonight, the jukebox playing, yeah, a tune about the wild side of life. As I listen to the words you are saying, it brings memories when I was a trusted wife. It wasn't God who made honky-tonk angels, as you said in the words of your song. Too many times married men think they're still single. That has caused many a good girl to go wrong. Shame that all the blame is on us women. It's not true that only men feel the same. It's from the start, most every heart that's ever broken was because there always was a man to blame. It wasn't God who honky-tonk angels, as you said in the words of your song. Too many times married men think they're still single. That has caused many a good girl soon go wrong.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
That's KDO, everybody. KDO. Great job, honey. Really good job. All right. A song back that became number one in 1952. How old were you then, Katie, in 52?
Let's see.
All right.
She was buried, and she was buried. Yeah, she was born in like 2006, right?
Right, something like that. I don't know. She's only
2005.
How old are you? 14 or 15? How old are you? 14. She's 14 years old, folks. Give her a round of applause. My gosh, that's incredible. All right, so remember now, folks, here we are in Nashville, Tennessee in the 50s, and you know that you got to come to Nashville to be a star, and this guy moved to town. I don't know a lot about him, but I do know this. I know that he came to town, he was friends, or he had some kind of acquaintance with Hank Williams, Sr. What it was exactly, I don't know. Maybe Dougie knows, but Dougie's going to tell you about another number one song in 1952.
That's right.
And he's going to tell you about it right now, because he can.
This young man moved to Nashville in 1952. He signed a record deal with Capitol Records, and when he was there, he got to be good friends with Hank Williams, and he took one of Hank's songs and recorded it, and this thing went right on up the charts. The trouble was that this fellow, Farron Young, got drafted into the Army, and he was actually in boot camp when this thing started going up the charts on the Billboard charts. Another interesting fact for Farron was that when he died, he was cremated, and they took his ashes out to Old Hickory Lake on Johnny and June's property and spread the ashes out there, but only when Johnny and June weren't home. So, and here's that number one hit for him in 1952 called Going Steady. Well, me and my baby, we're going steady. Ain't married yet, but we're getting ready to tie the knot. I'm gonna make her my own. Now that I found her, I'm gonna keep her. Finders, keepers, losers, weepers. She's my baby, she's going steady with me. Well, I've been honky-tonking round nearby all my life, and now I've got a steady babe. I'm gonna make her my loving wife. All you open round, I better leave her alone. Don't even call her on the phone. She's my baby, she's going steady with me. Little honky-tonk piano. Some guitar. Well now, sweet baby, that we're going steady, I'll go up and ask your daddy, what do you think if you and I are wed? I love you and you love me. We're both as happy as we can be. I hope your daddy will let you go steady with me. Well, we'll get the rings and be on our way to see that preacher man. And when you say I do, sweetheart, I slip that ring on your loving hand. Everything's gonna turn out fine. You'll be mine and I'll be yours. You're my baby, you're going steady with me. Let's turn it around. Yeah, you're my baby, you're going steady with me.
Chuck Stock, everybody.
The singing sheriff.
There's old Farron right there. Look at him up there in the back. Who's that in the background, too? I always like to look at those pictures and see who's in the background, because it's somebody, I don't know.
That's very young.
He's a great guy. All right, so folks, here's a really interesting story that I can kind of personalize a little bit, because there was a gentleman named Ernest Tubb that was a big star in the 40s and the 50s, and originally he put this song out called Walking the Floor Over You, and it was just him and the guitar back in the early days when they didn't have electric guitars and all that. And then when he got a band going and he got everything rolling along, he re-recorded the song. And the story I want to tell you about Ernest Tubb is kind of a personal story, but interesting. When I was a kid in high school, I had a little band called the Wildwood Playboys, and I got to open for Ernest Tubb. It was such a big deal because this is back a long time ago. Ernest Tubb was a big star. So my little band opens for Ernest Tubb, and I go get my picture made with Ernest Tubb and all the Texas troubadours. And if you remember back then, they didn't dress like we do now with holy jeans and no shoes. They had all these nudie suits. They all looked great. Well, their bus driver, also who used to sell merchandise, dressed up just like the guys in the band. And he was a member of the band, a lot like Nathan Smith is a member of our band out there. And so I got my picture made with him, and I was so proud. I was in 12th grade. And then I got drafted. But anyway, years later, the story I want to tell you is I was in a band called Sawyer Brown, and we needed a bus driver. And when we put out an ad for a bus driver, Ernest Tubb's bus driver applied for the job, and he took the job, and he drove bus for me for, he was out there for about 6 years with us. So I know every Ernest Tubb story there is, and it was about a year and a half before I found that picture, and I went and looked at it, and I said, you know who this is? So it was a great story, and I know his son watches once in a while, Jerry Don, and I sure miss your dad, because Pops was a great man. The story about walking the floor over you is this. At this point, the Grand Ole Opry do not want electric instruments on the stage. They don't want drummers. Of course, we all know why they wouldn't want that, right? Right, I mean, that's just a given. But they didn't want electric guitars. Well, Ernest Tubb's got a big record out there, a huge record with lots of electric guitars. So he goes to the Grand Ole Opry and says, if I don't play with my band and I don't have my guitars on there, I ain't coming. So he ended up being one of the first guys to bring electric guitars, I believe in about 1952, to the Grand Ole Opry. And his little record sounded a little like this.
You left me and you went away. You said you'd be back again today. You've broken your promises and left me here alone. I don't know why you did it, dear, but I do know that you're gone. How I'm walking the floor over you. I can't sleep a wink, that is true. I'm hoping and I'm praying my heart breaks right in two, walking the floor over you.
Come on.
Hey. Now, darling, you know I love you well. I love you more than I can ever tell. I thought you'd be loving me and always would be mine. But you went and left me here with troubles on my mind. Now I'm walking the floor over you. I can't sleep a wink, that is true. I'm hoping and I'm praying as my heart breaks right in two. Walking the floor over you.
Ernest Tubb right there, folks, with Walking the Floor Over You. And, of course, we all know Walls Across Texas with You. It's a big old song of his, too.
I would have done that one better.
Well, next time you can sing that. One more trivia question, trivia story on Ernest Tubb. Our second bus driver who showed up to drive our second bus, name was Dean Tubb. And that was Ernest Tubb's youngest kid who quit us after about 2 years and went to work for Charlie Daniels and drove bus for Charlie Daniels for many, many years. And, of course, we all know that story, where that ended. So let's move along. Here's what I want to tell you. So now in the 50s, the music is starting to change. So you know how y'all hate country music today, how y'all don't like the new stuff anyway. I don't. But the music's starting to change because it's becoming less acoustic, less of this kind of bass guitar. And there was two guys that were kind of battling out for a guitar position in the country music world. There was Gibson guitars and there were Fender guitars. I'm playing a Gretsch guitar, but that's kind of a thick-bodied guitar, as you can see. It's not a slab-bodied guitar. And so those guitars, if you turn them up very loud, they'll start feeding back. They'll make a lot of noise. And they figured out that the slab guitar would not do that. That you could turn this guitar up and it will get real loud and it won't feed back. So a guy on the West Coast by the name of Leo Fender is trying to develop the guitar and trying to get the country music people to play it, because everybody was playing Gibson guitars. Everybody, Ernest Tubb, Hank Thompson, all those guys played Gibson guitars, big old fat bodies like that. Of course, Leo Fender was also doing that, but there was a guy named Les Paul who was making slab guitars out of Gibson, trying to get the country music to do it. Of course, we all know that they went on to be rock guitars. But I want to tell you something. Because of those guys, I was a fan of the Telecaster guitar. When I was a kid, I wanted a Telecaster guitar. I bought this guitar when I was in 11th grade, and I've had it ever since.
In the 1930s?
In the 30s. It's right. Well, no, actually, I was in the 11th grade almost all of the 70s. It took me a while. It's a little rough. But I saw two guys. One guy you know. There was a guy in my hometown named Jim Fritzler, and he played in a band with this guy who was a big, famous guy in our local area named Butch Heath, and he had a Telecaster. He had a lot of money. I didn't. And there was another guy named Don Rich that had one of these, so I saved all my money to buy this guitar. And as the music was changing, remember, this was too rock and roll to be on the Grand Ole Opry, because Buck Owens was never made a member of the Grand Ole Opry, or Merle Haggard. Why? Because their music was too, what would you call
it? Risqué.
Too twangy to be on the Grand Ole. But when I bought this guitar, it's the first song I learned on it.
Ready?
Song
Buckaroo, recorded by the Buck Owens Band. Don Rich playing guitar, and I believe that was probably Tom Brumley playing the steel guitar on that. So, and that was too crazy of music to be on the Grand Ole Opry. Now we would just only pray to Jesus that they could play that kind of music on the Grand Ole Opry, as opposed to whatever that noise is they're playing them. So in 1956, I don't know the story about this lady, but she ended up in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but started out in the country music field. And I think we have Katie O again. Now, we're going to not do that version of her song, but you're going to recognize this song. But I want you to know that this song first came out in 1956. If Katie O is not back there playing cards and gambling with Macy Mac, smoking cigarettes, maybe she could come out here and sing a song with us.
Smoking cigarettes.
And watching Captain Kangaroo.
So Wanda Jackson, she was named the first lady of rockabilly, and actually she was the original singer of the song Silver Threads and Golden Needles, and many people over the years have covered that song, and I'm going to sing that one for y'all. I don't want your lonely mansion with a tear in every room. All I want is the love you promised me. that you think I should be happy with your money and your name, and hide myself in sorrow while you play your cheating game. Silver threads and golden needles cannot mend this heart of mine. I dare not drown my sorrow in the warm glow of your wine. You can't buy my love with money, for I never was that kind. Silver threads and golden needles cannot mend this heart of mine.
Bobby on the fiddle.
Threads and golden needles cannot mend this heart of mine. And I dare not drown my sorrow in the warm glow of your wine. You can't buy my love with money, for I never was that kind. Silver threads and golden needles cannot mend this heart of mine. A silver threads and golden man, this heart of mine.
Yeah, Katie O.
Thank you.
Good job, Katie.
Hey, you can go this way back.
Yeah.
That was great, wasn't it?
Yeah.
My gosh, these kids are so good. So good. 14 years old, too. My gosh. All right, so now we're going to move on into the 60s. Are y'all with me? All right, you still having a good time? Yeah, everybody's okay? Is this informational, or do you want me to start doing a bunch of jokes and something like that? Or just
hee-haw jokes.
Yeah, and hee-haw jokes. So, you know, people are moving to Nashville, I told you, for different reasons. Here's a great story. There's a guy named Harlan Howard who has written, if you need to Google his name sometime, he's written thousands of standard songs for
over
years.
Over 4,000, they said, on Google.
In the 60s, 70s, 80s, and even 90s, he had hit records that this guy has written songs. So anyway, here's his story. He's in this little town called Detroit, Michigan, and he's trying to listen to the Grand Ole Opry. And he's kind of a wannabe singer. I think he's like 13 years old. And he wants to listen to the Grand Ole Opry. Well, those of you who know, if you lived a long ways away, a lot of times it would cut out and cut in. You'd be out there trying to cuss at the radio. And, of course, I don't cuss, but anyway, my dad did. So it would go off and on. And so he's trying to learn these songs. And he said that he couldn't get the words. He's trying to write them down to sing this song. He'd start writing down the words. The radio would go out, and he couldn't figure out what the words were. So he said he started making up his own words to put him in there. Arlen does it every night. Sits there through the songs.
I do. I'm sorry.
Writes his own songs as we go. But so anyway, he writes this song. He goes to Nashville, and in 1962, I believe, this was the first song that he got recorded, and it became a number one record by a guy who also had moved to Nashville, who was a disc jockey in Texas, and moved to Texas, and so simultaneously, they both had a number one record. Harlan Howard, this was his first number one record, and a guy named Charlie Walker, well, this was also their first number one record, and it goes a little like this, if you will.
You were mine for just a while, now you're putting on the style, and you never once looked back at your home across the tracks. You're the gossip of the town, and my heart can still be found where you tossed it on the ground. Pick me up on your way down. Pick me up on your way down, when you're blue and all alone. When the glamour starts to bore you, come on back where you belong. You may be their pride and joy, but they'll find another toy. When you tumble to the ground, pick me up on your way down. Oh, come on, Doug. You haughty and so rude. Your new friends can take the blame. Underneath, you're still the same. But when you learn these things are true, I'll be waiting here for you. When you tumble to the ground, pick me up on your way down. Yeah, pick me up on your way down. When you're blue and all alone, when the glamour starts to bore you, come on back where you belong. You may be there for pride and joy, but they'll find another toy. When you take away your crown, pick me up on your way down. A little tag. So when you tumble to the ground, pick me up on your way down. Yeah!
Yeah! Charlie Walker's first number one record, and the guy who played the pedal steel, for all you steel players out there, any steel players out there? None? His name was Jimmy Day, who was also a kind of an icon, wouldn't you say, Dougie?
He is, definitely.
Yeah, he was kind of a big shot. He's kind of a big deal. All right, so in 1960, it was a really good year for the Grand Ole Opry because a lot of guys came to the Grand Ole Opry. Billy Walker was signed in 1960. Bill Anderson, Sonny James, Ernie Ashworth, Charlie Walker. But now, the girls are finally starting to pop through a little bit. We had, in the 60s, Patsy Cline, Loretta Lynn, Dottie West, Tammy Wynette. So the girls are starting to kind of make a name for themselves. So I thought we'd do a little bit of some girls stuff for you. Is that be okay? All right. We're not keeping you awake, are we? Or are we? We are? No, we're not. Okay. All right. Just wanted to make sure.
Hey, we all slept through the Grand Ole Opry.
Yeah, I went to the Grand Ole Opry and fell asleep. I did. Right in the wood benches years ago. Just kind of did. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have a young lady here who's going to come out and she's one of our favorites here at the Orange Blossom Opry. She's a real sweetheart. I can tell you that microphone's too high already.
let's see if it is.
We'll see if it got it. I don't think you do. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Macy Mack. Here she is.
Macy! Yeah! Macy!
Guitar's up there.
Oh, your guitar's over there, honey. We moved your guitar. Our stage started to look like a junkyard up here, and there's just stuff everywhere. So I moved your guitar, but I'll even get the...
Look, and I think the mic's almost perfect. She stands on her tippy toes.
These guys are such gentlemen.
Well, when you become a big star, you remember me, and you don't pay any attention to these knuckleheads up here.
Yes, sorry.
Don't ask us to go on the road with you, though.
Yeah, we're already done with that. All right.
All right, can I say a little facts about Patsy Cline real quick?
You can say whatever you like, honey.
All right, so Patsy Cline, she was inducted into the Grand Ole Opry January of 1960. And believe it or not, she was born September 8th, 1932. And I was born September 9th, 2003. So we're both September birthdays. And another fact is that she was, at the age of 13, she was hospitalized for a sore throat and a rheumatic fever. I think that's how you say that word.
Rheumatic fever, yeah.
Cool, I'm a doctor. she was hospitalized, and after she recovered, quoting from Patsy Cline, she came out with this booming voice, as she'd like to say. So ain't that cool?
Yeah.
You know, were you then 2 days old for 9/11?
No, that was 2001.
Oh, okay.
So, yes. I think that happened 2 years.
2 years and 2 days.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
All
right.
Yes, I've got brains today. All right.
I've got your picture that you gave to me,
yeah.
And it's signed with love, just like it used to be. The only thing different, the only thing new. I've got your picture, she's got you. I've got the records that we used to share, and they still sound the same as when you were here. The only thing different, the only thing new. I've got the records, she's got you. I've got your memory, or has it got me? I really don't know, but I know it won't let me be. I've got your class ring that proved you care, and it still looks the same as when you gave it, dear. The only thing different, the only thing new. I've got these little things, she's got you. I've got your class ring that proved you care, and it still looks the same as when you gave it, dear. The only thing different, the only thing new. I've got these little things.
That's Macy Mack, everybody.
Thank y'all.
My gosh, that's incredible. Yeah. My gosh, that is so good. Thank you, honey. Patsy Cline right there. All right. Hey, folks, I want to take a second and tell you that we got a couple of other great shows coming up next week on Saturday night, I guess it is. We're going to do a CD release party. We've been working really hard on this time you can stay up here if you want. To record a new CD, and we're going to play a bunch of songs off the new CD next Saturday. Is that right, Dougie? I don't know what day it is. It's Saturday. Friday we'll be doing songs of the 70s, and Saturday we'll be doing something like that. Is that right? Is she a leaving, or is she sticking around?
Excuse me, but I think you got
She'll be back, though. She'll be back. All right, so also now, moving along, there's another guy. You know, remember, folks are moving to Nashville like crazy in the 60s to become a star. And I remember in the 60s, in the late 60s, the draft was going on. So I did the right thing. I immediately moved to Canada. But there was a...
That's not true.
But my draft number was 16, if you want to know the truth. Not in the 60s. So anyway, there was a gentleman that moved there by the name of Sonny James. Y'all remember Sonny James? Yep. He was called the... What was he called? What?
Southern gentleman
is what he was called, and that's why we picked Kevin to sing this. No, that doesn't sound at all right, does it?
No, he's a
That's
southern,
perfect for me.
He's a
perfect.
Southern gentleman.
He's a, Kevin's perfect. A Southern gentleman. He's from Illinois, though, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
Southern Illinois.
Southern Illinois. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. And yes, ma'am, to you.
What are you going
to
do, Wichita?
I'm going to do bullets here. What's going on? 1962 Grand Ole Opry member, yeah. Right? And we're going to do the number one song that he had, Young Love. Let's try it. They say for every boy and girl there's just one love in this world. And I found mine. The heavenly touch of your embrace tells me no one can take your place ever in my heart. A young love, first love, she had with deep emotion. Young love. Kiss from your sweet lips will tell me that your love is real, and I feel that's true. We will vow to one another, there will never be another love for me. A young love, first love. Share the deep emotion, young love, our love, we feel with deep devotion. Oh, Sonny Jane.
Kingston right there, folks. He's going to be doing a show here in not too long. All songs by Creedence Clearwater Revival. He will
be
doing
awesome.
That's going to be absolutely awesome.
2 weeks from now, right?
2 weeks from now, right?
Yeah. And They're selling fast.
Yep, tickets are selling fast. And I don't want to say that.
Well, if there's some left, buy the rest of them.
Buy the rest of them.
Come on out.
That's right. Come on out and see Kevin.
You could have done Kevin doing Sonny James doing CCR.
That's right. He'll be doing Sonny James doing CCR on what? I've really got lost. But anyway, are y'all having a good time so far? Okay. So remember now, Nashville's kind of becoming just a hodgepodge. People are moving in. People are doing this and everything. And you do anything you can to get a record deal. I remember me telling you how hot and how popular Ernest Tubb was. Do you know that Ernest Tubb had two people that started out in his band that went on to have careers of their own? One was a bass player. Do anybody know who his bass player was? Not in the band, because they all know. Someone out there, do you know, sir? You're from Ocala, so probably not.
I know.
What about you, honey? Do you know? Does anybody know who played bass for Ernest Tubb in the early days? You don't? This guy who probably never amounted to much, but his name was Willie Nelson. He was who did I just say? Ernest Tubb's... not boyfriend, bass player. Good grief. I bumped my head as a kid. So anyway, he also had a... I did fall on my head. He also had a A drummer that became famous that could actually, I don't want to say he could sing better than
Ernest. I was going to ask you, was that drummer playing drums with him when you opened for him in high school?
No, he wasn't.
He wasn't.
He wasn't, nor okay. was Willie. Because that was, when I opened for him was in the, well, it'd be in 1970. And by then, Willie had already left. And Jack Green, was who I'm talking about, is his drummer. Yeah. And he had left, too, because he sang this song. And we decided to do a Jack Green song. It didn't take us long to decide who was going to sing the song.
I got to tell you, they had a Opry on the road, and they came into Michigan, and I was asked to play the piano. So I actually got to play this song with Jack Green as the singer, and I was his piano player. I was very, very honored to do that.
Hey, don't you have this on a CD song?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes, we do. Thank you, because Desiree would be so mad at me. We recorded a CD with 16 songs on it, and we put this song on it. Thank you, Nathan, our sound guy back there. He's our recording recording studio engineer, and he sure... helped me, you know, he's back there going, sing it again, sing it again.
That's not good enough.
Well, yeah. So, anyways, this song's on there, and we're going to have a record release party, and that is next week?
Yeah, next Saturday,
Saturday, yeah.
We're going to be giving away a bunch of stuff, too. So you get a CD, you're going to get free T-shirts. Right. You'll get tickets to some of these other shows. That's next Saturday, folks. You need to come out. We'll play all of the songs we recorded on our new CD. Will we not?
Yes.
Is your wife happy now?
Yes, she's happy now.
Okay, good.
Don't take my tape. We're in B, right?
What's that?
In B, right?
We're in the key of B, right? Where's B? All right, I wrote it.
One, two. Somewhere. For all the world to see, a statue of a fool made of stone. The image of a man who let love slip through his hand. And then just let him stand there all alone. And there on his face, the gold tears should be placed to honor. And the hurt in his eyes would show, so everyone would know that concealed was a broken heart inside. So
Jack right there. There's a picture of Jack Green up there. My gosh. Good job, Arlen.
You know, our buddies in Michigan are probably already looking at your guitars and saying, B, what?
Do what?
I sang that song in C for a long time.
Oh, now you're singing in B. Is that lower than C?
Yes, it
is. Well, yeah, but I mean, so what does that mean?
I got to tell y'all, and not to be a downer or anything, but 4 years ago, I had cancer in my throat. And it didn't kill my voice, thank the Lord. And it was answered prayers for sure. But definitely that song takes a harder hit on you.
Well, you would never know it.
Because of it.
I would have shared that story, but I didn't want to. Because Arlen called me one day, and I've known Arlen. We've known each other for years. And when he told me he had throat cancer, and the doctor said, you may never speak again. You may never sing again. Arlen said, well, there's somebody upstairs that may have a different opinion than that. And through power of prayer, that...
I was like, you want a bet, buddy?
No. That's not funny.
Sorry.
None of that's funny.
It's not even funny, is it?
Well, you got to laugh about it, because you can laugh or cry. We got any cancer survivors out there? Not to turn it down. Or anybody else? I am.
Yep, all right.
There we all are. Well, God bless each and every one of
you.
So there you go. All right. So let's move along. Now... you know, what happens is guys are writing songs, and people are moving to town, and people are trying to get songs written and recorded, and there's a guy who cannot sing a lick, but he can write the fire out of songs. His name was Bill Anderson. He had his own kind of thing. He'd become a really big star, Whispering Bill. He wasn't a screamer. He's a great guy. That guy's written more songs than you'll ever know. He's probably one of the most... one of the greatest songwriters ever, without a doubt, one of the greatest songwriters. And so he found this young lady. Where's she from? Do y'all know? Is she from Ohio, I think? Why do I want to see Connie Smith?
Probably knows.
Yeah, she probably does. Where's Katie O? Is she back there?
No, it's a Macy song.
Oh, Macy's song. Macy's coming. So Macy, are you back there, honey?
Macy,
where are you? See, those kids sit back there and they gamble and they smoke cigarettes and
cigars,
and you can't get them out here to sing. There you are.
All right.
Playing guitar?
You're playing guitar, honey? You are? Well, Arlen will get your guitar. Watch this. Just like that, it'll happen. There you go.
There we go. Thank you. Thank you. How y'all doing? Sorry.
Women.
Me and Katie, we've been chatting backstage. You know how us women are. Yes. All right.
TG, fellas, is that right, Dougie? Okay.
Okie doke. So can I say a couple facts about Connie Smith?
Sure.
Right quick. All right. So Connie Smith was inducted into the Grand Ole Opry in 1965.
Wow.
And as y'all might know, she is married to fellow musician Marty Stewart. They got married in 1997. And the first time that Marty Stewart met Connie, well, kind of, he went to one of her concerts at the age of 12. And the first time he saw her, he was like, I'm going to marry that girl one day. And he did.
Finally got to. So,
there you go.
Got him an old cougar.
So, yes, their age gap is 17 years apart.
No kidding.
Wow. I didn't know they were that far apart.
So, Macy, you know, guys may be coming to your concert looking at you going, you know what, I'm going to marry that girl someday.
Actually, I've had a couple guys wink at me from the audience, and I'm like, oh, okay.
Well, if it's any of us up here, we'll be arrested, so you won't have to worry about it.
I was like, yeah, this ain't that type of show, man. Nah. But, and another thing, she was discovered by Bill Anderson at a talent contest. So that's pretty cool. Yeah,
do you know where she was from?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you know where she was from?
I want to say she's from Ohio, and I don't know why, but I want to say.
No, only terrorists come from Ohio.
Yeah. Well, that and Buckeyes.
Buckeyes.
All right, we got to move along.
All right.
Just kidding, Ohio. I love
yes.
you.
Yes.
Yep.
All right.
Somebody new, I thought I never would forget you, for I thought then I never could. But time has taken all the pains away. Until now, I'm down to hurting a day. Once a day.
Once a day.
All day long.
All day long.
And once a night.
Once a night.
From dusk till dawn.
Dusk till dawn.
The only time. She loved and slowly lost her mind. She sat around and cried her life away. Lucky me, I'm only crying once a day. Once a day.
Once a day.
All day long.
All day.
Mac, everybody. My gosh, that's absolutely killer. Thank you, honey. She'll be back again. Just yank it out of there. There you go. Okay, y'all set, hon? You can put a mic thing right back here if you want. All right, we're moving right along. We're in the 60s, folks, and they said this guy came to town, and he couldn't figure out who he was. He said he sounded like everybody, but he could never find out who he was. And I can't remember who his producer was, if it was Billy Sherrill, none of that matters. Anyway, he said, you got to go find your own voice. And so he went and found his own voice, and it was a big one. We're talking about the legendary George Jones, who came to the...
And I got to tell you that...
Yeah, tell him the story about this song, because this is a great story about this song.
This song was originally written by a good friend of mine and Bobby's, and he should be watching right now. His name is Dickie Lee. And now, if you know Dickie Lee, he's had a lot of hit songs throughout the years that he has written. And in the 80s, he had a song that was 9,999,000. You remember that song?
Yeah.
Well, he wrote this song for George Jones way back in the 60s, in 62, I believe it was. And after that, not only did George Jones have a number one hit two more times throughout the years, up into the 80s and that, Elvis had a number one hit with it, James Taylor, Trisha Yearwood, and just a whole handful of people had number one hit songs with this song. So
he also wrote Keeper of the Stars for Tracy Bird and that big song for Doug Stone.
Oh, every morning I watch you.
Yeah, yeah. Anyway, yeah, he's an incredible songwriter. And the thing about, cool thing
I
about
I see you in
Dickie
a different
Lee,
light. Sorry.
That's okay. He and I share the same birthday.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, September 21st. So,
but not the same birth year?
No, he's a lot older than I am. Jeez, he's way older than I am. Good grief. Love you,
Dickie. He's a great guy, and we got to play a whole bunch of gigs with him, and we had a lot of fun, and he's a good Christian man, and I just love him to death, and I hope you're watching right now, Dickie.
Yep.
I'll be calling you later to see.
He'll be critiquing. He's watching. All right.
Just because I ask a friend about her, and just because I spoke her name somewhere, just because I rang her number by mistake today, she thinks I still care. And just because I haunt the same old places where the memory of her lingers everywhere. It's because I rang her number by mistake today. She thinks I'm still care, and she's really thinking I still need her. And let that silly notion bring her cheer. How could she ever be so foolish? Where did she get such an idea? Just because I ask a friend about her, and just because I spoke her name somewhere, just because I saw her then went all to pieces, she thinks I'm still care. Oh, she thinks I'm still care.
George Jones right there, song written by Dickie Lee. Arlen Blitz singing for you. Well, speaking of George Jones, you know that he became a monster star. He's originally from Texas, I believe. But this next young lady had also a tremendous career and started out. You ought to look up the story about Tammy Wynette sometime, because she's got an incredible story about how hard she worked to move to Nashville. I think she had three kids and was a single mom and all these things that she had to come up with. But she wrote a couple of pretty good songs, and I think this one is the one that brought her to the party. Is Macy singing?
Hey, Macy.
Yeah, Macy, come on out here and sing for us here, because you're probably the only, there's not many folks that can sing this song, and you absolutely blew the walls out of this place.
Oh, my goodness.
It was incredible.
Oh, thanks.
Incredible.
It's a real good song. All right. Y'all ready for them facts?
Yep.
Yes.
All right.
The facts. Just give us the facts.
Well, we are going back to school, so we've got to get in that momentum again. So, but Tammy Wynette, she was inducted into the Grand Ole Opry in 1970, I believe. And believe it or not, she was a trained, like, she had a lot of side jobs besides just being a, you know, an amazing singer, songwriter, musician. She was a trained cosmetologist.
Huh.
So, and she is from Itawamba County, Mississippi. I'm a Mississippi girl myself, so kudos to her. But she got her license in Tupelo, Mississippi for cosmetology. And another fact is that she had 20 number one hits.
Wow.
Man.
Amazing.
Legendary woman, huh? All right.
Well, we hope you have 20 number one records.
Yes,
well,
we do.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
I hope so. Maybe. One day. We'll see.
It's hard to be a woman, giving all your love to just one man. You'll have bad times, and he'll have good times, doing things that you don't understand. But if you love him, you'll forgive him, even though he's hard to understand. And if you love him, oh, be proud of him, 'cause after all, just a man.
Everybody. Oh, great job. Man. All right. Send KDO out here because we got to get rolling along. We're going to try to get all these songs in here. We might run over a little bit. You don't mind if we run over a little bit, right? It's 8:30 right now. If you'll just sit still, we should be done by like 5 to 11. So, and there's a KDO right there. And we could not leave out this next lady. And you sing her songs as good as anybody I've ever heard sing.
Thank you.
That's absolutely fact. Tell them what you're going to do. You can speak for yourself.
Well, Loretta Lynn, who was born in Butcher Holler, Kentucky, she, as y'all know, she's an amazing singer. But other than that, she was also and is also an amazing songwriter. And many of her songs she wrote by herself, including this one. Here's "You Ain't Woman Enough to Take My Man." You've come to tell me something you say I ought to know. That he don't love me anymore, and I'd have to let him go. Well, you say you're gonna take him, oh, but I don't think you can. 'Cause you ain't woman enough to take my man. Women like you, they're a dime a dozen. Buy him anywhere. For you to get to him, I'd have to move over, and I'm gonna stand right here. Well, it'll be over my dead body, so get out while you can. 'Cause you ain't woman enough to take my man. Start looking at things I hate on me. He took a second look at you, but he's in love with me. I don't know where that leaves you, oh, but I know where I stand. 'Cause you ain't woman enough to take my man. Yeah, women like you, they're a dime a dozen. You can buy them anywhere. For you to get to him, I'd have to move over, and I'm gonna stand right here. Well, it'll be over my dead body, so get out while you can. 'Cause you ain't woman enough to take my man. No, you ain't woman enough to take my man.
Yeah, KDO.
Thank you.
That's KDO, everybody. It's the night of pretty girls and lots of girls' songs. All right, we got to keep moving right along. And another lady that was made it in the country music business, I actually had the opportunity to work with her. I toured with Kenny Rogers for about 2.5 years, and Dolly Parton was out there a lot. And the other times when she wasn't out there, a lady named Dottie West came out there. Y'all remember Dottie West? And Macy's going to come out here. This is one of my favorite Dottie West songs. Where's Macy now, you suppose? Well, there she is. All right. Macy was in our Christmas show. Did you all see Macy in the Christmas show? She was absolutely incredible. And the Christmas show.
I think she was an inch shorter then.
No, but she drank all the punch. I got it.
As long as it was spiked. I'm just kidding. Oh,
no
Lord.
Way.
You don't need no spiked punch.
Mm-mm.
You don't need no stinking spike punch.
No, I'm already crazy enough sober. I don't need another.
All right, this is in a weird key, right? C sharp?
C-sharp. Believe me.
Oh, boy.
All right. I got some more facts, y'all.
Okay.
Y'all ready for it?
Let her rip.
All right. So Dottie West, she was inducted the same year as Connie Smith, which was 1965, to the Grand Ole Opry. And she was the oldest of 10 children. Wow. 10.
I didn't know that, really.
That's kids.
Yeah. I don't have any siblings, so I would not know at all what that life is like. But also, Dottie West was really good friends with Patsy Cline. And Patsy Cline mentored her throughout her whole career, which is really cool. So,
oh, look at that.
Yes.
Wow.
So that's how you know that Patsy Cline was a pretty good woman. So us girls got to stick together.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Anyway, so.
C-sharp, is that it?
Yes, sir. All righty. Somebody's gonna give you less and then leave, and somebody's gonna give you back what you've been given. I hope that I'm around to watch them knock you down. It's like you love them and leave, and just like you love me and left me, it's like you do that sort of thing over and over again. You're a full-hearted man. Asking about me from some of my friends. Well, you better believe I'm not going through that again. You're the kind of man a woman thinks she can change, but the only thing changing is my way of thinking. And I'm thinking that maybe someday somebody's gonna give you a lesson at least, and somebody's gonna do to you what you've been doing. And I hope that I'm around, watch them knock you down. Somebody's gonna give you a lesson and hurt, and somebody's gonna leave you the earth fire burning and no way to put it out. Baby, there ain't no doubt you're a full-hearted man. Take it!
Somebody's gonna give you back what you've been given. I hope that I'm around to watch them knock you down. Oh, it's like you love and leave, and just like you love me and left me, it's like you to do that sort of thing over and over again.
Somebody's gonna give you a lesson and leave, and somebody's gonna give you back what you've been given. And I hope that I'm around to watch them knock you down. Oh, it's like you love them and leave them, just like you love me and left me. It's like you to do that sort of thing over and over again. You're a full-hearted man.
Yeah, Macy Mack, everybody.
Thank y'all.
Good job, honey. Oh, great job. All right, we're moving right along. We got one person as we kind of crowd up with our girl singers. Have the ladies not done an incredible job
wonderful,
tonight?
Wonderful, wonderful.
Great job. Usually we do this show with a lot of guy songs in it, and I thought, well, we've got two cute little girls that can just are incredible singers. Why not have them sing, and we'll just sit back here and play. Did you all enjoy yourself? Did you learn anything at all tonight about the Grand Ole Opry? You learned something you didn't know? All right.
Well, did you take notes?
Did you take notes? Because there will be a quiz later. All right. Katie O, come on out here because we left out a girl. And Katie's going to come out here. Do we know what key we're going to do this in? We did not rehearse this song.
I got B flat to B on this.
B flat to B. Okay. All right. That'll be all right.
To be or not to be. Is
B what?
To be or not to be.
To be or B. Not to be. All right. All right. Well, you got to say whatever you're.
Well, Tanya Tucker, she started in the country music business at a very young age, and she had her first hit when she was only 13 years old with the song Delta Dawn. So I hope y'all enjoy this song.
Delta Dawn, what's that flower you have on? Could it be a faded rose from days gone by? And did I hear you say he wasn't meeting you here today to take you to his mansion in the sky? Well, she's 41 and her daddy still calls her baby, and all the folks around Brownsville say she's crazy, 'cause she walks downtown with a suitcase in her hand, looking for a mysterious dark-haired man. Well, in her younger days, they called her Delta Dawn, the prettiest woman you'd ever lay eyes on. But then a man of a low degree stood by her side and promised her he'd take her for his bride. Delta Dawn, what's that flower you have on? Could it be a faded rose from days gone by? And did I hear you say he wasn't meeting you here today to take you to his mansion in the sky? Delta Dawn, what's that flower you have on? Could it be a faded rose from days gone by? And did I hear you say he wasn't meeting you here today to take you to his mansion in the sky? Delta Dawn, what's that flower you have on? Could it be a faded rose from days gone by? And did I hear you say he wasn't meeting you here today to take you to his mansion in the sky? Delta Dawn, what's that flower you have on? Could it be a faded rose from days gone by? And did I hear you say he wasn't meeting you here today to take you to his mansion in the sky?
Katie O, everybody.
Thank you.
Hope you all had a great time tonight. We are the Orange Blossom Opry Band. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. Thank you, everybody, on Facebook. We love you. Be sure to join us again here Thursday night. Come on out as I have our showcase. A lot of great things going on here. Go to the website. Check out theorangeblossomopry.com. God bless each and every one of you. Y'all get up tomorrow morning and go to church. We'll see you again. Thanks, everybody.